Big crowd. Thanks for coming in and not enjoying the nice weather. When I arrived yesterday, it was a little cooler, and I was actually really enjoying it because at home in Austria we had 35 degrees over the last 2.5 weeks every day. And so actually some cool temperatures was actually very well received. Before I get started, I want to know a little bit about you as an audience, because I want to make sure that I address the needs that you have from a performance perspective and from a Java perspective in general. So I assume all of you are Java coders. Is anybody not doing Java and just interested in Java performance? Okay. Is anybody doing testing? Yeah? Yeah? What type of testing?
Well, mostly Android testing and, mm-hmm. well, you know, project decoupled from the called Android ecosystem, mm-hmm. so with Robo Electric and so on, and using it to unit test, well, functions and methods.
Okay. Is anybody doing performance testing, load testing? So that means when I give a talk about performance, nobody's doing performance testing.
There.
Huh? Where?
Well, we try.
We try?
No, how it is.
Yeah, yeah.
We write software this.
Of course, no. Every engineer built the best software ever, and I'll have some examples of engineers like you that raised their voice very clearly. Okay. Obviously, I cannot speak Polish. I had no clue what he was telling before. At least, I mean, I heard the word microservices a lot. That's the only thing I got, and I think there's a conference coming up, yeah. So that's good. I tend to speak faster when I get excited. So please let me know if I should slow down a little bit, because performance is a topic that I'm very excited about, because I've been doing performance for the last 15 years. So I want to tell you a little bit about this. Before I get started, however, I also want to show you actually where I'm really from, because maybe, I'm not sure how many of you made it to Austria. Has anybody been to Austria? Hey, who has been to Linz? All my colleagues, of course. So Linz is a beautiful industrial city on the Donau, the Danube River, and a lot of people hopefully get there enjoy the view like this. This is the Danube, and Linz is divided by the Danube into two halves, Linz City and the north part, which is also part of Linz, but the people, it's kind of like very interesting. I grew up on the north part, and we were also always bitching about the main people of the main city. Now I moved to the main city, now I have a little dilemma. But it's beautiful, and Linz is actually, for software people and IT folks, actually very well known for this building. It's the Ars Electronica Center. It's our future lab. We have a pre-electronica which has been in place for 25 years, where people that do software and that do actually art with software get awards every year. So in case you have never heard about it, Ars Electronica and the Ars Electronica Festival, and that's the futuristic museum that we have. Linz is also very well known for some pastry. It's the Linzer Torte, in case you have heard about it. Those colleagues that have been in Linz, have you tried it?
Yeah.
It's typically very dry, and you need to...
We focus mainly on beer while we travel.
Say it again?
We focus mainly on beer while we travel.
Talking about beer? Yeah, here we go. So I just wanted to show you that we do not only sell pastry that is very dry to sell more coffee, so the coffee houses sell more coffee. We also enjoy beer a lot. So do I when I travel to Poland. There's a lot of great beer here. So this is a little bit about where I'm from, so maybe one of these days you make it to Linz and enjoy all of this. I want to tell you why I'm here today and why I think I can tell you something about performance. 15 years ago, I started working for a company called Segway. Has anybody heard about Segway? Not talking about this driving thing, no? Segway?
No.
Segway is actually a company that I started with 15 years ago, and we did load and performance testing. So we built our own testing tools, and I actually started as a tester, then I became a developer, a product manager, and then at some point in time my boss told me, it's better you don't code anymore because there's other people that code better than you. But it's better if you help people use our tools and break their apps and tell them not only that their apps break, but also why they break. Okay, I did that in total for 7.5 years. Segway later became Borland, if you may remember that name, some of you. Borland probably more known from development tools. Back then, when Borland acquired Segway, Borland refocused and only did testing. So I did that for 7 years, and I remember my first engagement. I was 20 years old, and it was the first time I had to drive to Germany to the unemployment office, or to the Ministry of Unemployment. And if you remember the name Hartz, Hartz IV, they are the big change that they did in law about 12 years ago. They built a new platform based on the new laws, and the goal of this application was to sustain 100,000 concurrent users. Because they had a lot of offices around the world and they wanted to have every German citizen to be able to go online and check their unemployment payments. And I was very excited about this. I had a full week planned and my whole thing was done after 30 minutes. Why? Because I got there, we started the load test and the application crashed with 10 users on the system. And this was my first cool experience. I was very proud, but on the other side it was also very boring. So I did a lot of testing on the performance side. That's why I asked who is doing testing. So I did a lot of load and performance testing. After 7 years, I actually followed the call of my former boss. He founded Dynatrace. And he tried to solve the problem of not breaking apps, but actually sitting, especially back then, in Java applications and trying to figure out why they are slow. Is it a method that you implemented? Is it a database query? Is it memory leaks? So we built a product that could sustain load, collect a lot of performance metrics without impacting load. I followed him and basically the same thing happened. He said, don't code. You tried that 10 years ago. Just help people and figuring out what's going wrong. Dynatrace later became CompuWare. We got acquired a couple of years ago. But since end of last year, we are back to Dynatrace. And this is kind of my circle of professional life. And as you can see, I'm wearing it with pride. I really love the product, and I'm not paid. I'm not a sales guy. I'm still doing engineering. I don't get paid for this, but I love it so much, and I'm wearing this shirt. And actually, we also have an office here in Gdansk, just 2 minutes down that road, and we are hiring as well, in case somebody is looking for job opportunities. But enough about this. What I'm really here about is telling you some of my experiences. And it's not a blank page, but what I hear and see a lot is that nobody in the world wants things like this to happen. If you're responsible, I'm not talking about Apple now, but if you're responsible, if you're building a great website and it doesn't work, then this is not a good thing. Who is responsible? Who built code for a public website? Nobody? Nobody's doing any website development? Really? Only you two guys, I think. What is the rest doing here? Anyway, if it's a website or software that doesn't work, it is bad. And in case even it happens to the big ones, and I guess the only people that are happy if this happens, in this case, if Apple goes down, is if you're working for Google or Microsoft. But in general, nobody likes this, nor do people like this. This is the FIFA World Cup app, and you talked about Android. The FIFA World Cup app, 2 weeks before the World Cup last year, crashed for 80% of Android users when they launched the app and refreshed the first screen. The first screen was the news entry, what's going on right now in the World Cup, and they used an outdated library that had a memory leak. An outdated library, it was well known, and they crashed 80%. Of all the apps, 2 weeks before the World Cup. Fortunately, they fixed it, but this was kind of an embarrassing moment. Why is this a problem? Because typically it leads to things like this. This is not a party. I know I'm using a lot of references from the US because I'm doing a lot of business in the US. This is a so-called war room, even though I know we Europeans don't like the term war at all, but this is kind of what it is. It is something really broken and failed, and people now need to fix the problem. They need to sit together in a room, and this was the war room at Facebook in December 2012 when Facebook went down for a couple of hours. Why is this bad? It's bad because they don't make money, because everybody that likes to post pictures of cats or tells friends how often they go to the toilet they also, Facebook posts links on there and people click on it. And if the Facebook thing goes down, then it's this problem. I did the same presentation in December in Seattle. And actually a guy who was sitting in this room said, I was actually there. It's true. And he said, it's not fun. it's really, I know that, I'm not sure if anybody of you had these critical situations. Calling, everybody's calling friendly, software doesn't work, it's not fun typically. Because potentially things like this, if you are a company like Facebook and Apple, and I'm sure I can give other examples, leads to things like this. FIFA scores an own goal with buggy mobile app. If the FIFA gets pressed like this, this does not help them to get more people on their app. The same is true if Facebook goes down hours after Gmail outage, and this is, I like this one, sets off panic or delight. It depends on who you see. Yeah, a lot of Facebook people probably went to Twitter to continue their social life. So Twitter was, I'm sure, delighted. Facebook was in panic. It also leads to things like this. I'm picking on you. What's your name, by the way?
Andre.
So if you are building the next greatest mobile Android app and you are, it is as buggy as the FIFA app, then you may get things like this. This is the screenshot of the Google Play Store for the FIFA app. And all of these things in red, these are people that don't really have nice things to say. And if you are creating the next cool app and you get reviews like this, nobody's going to use your app, but probably the 50 other apps that are already out there that do the same thing or similar things. That's the world we're living in. The question is why? I use some references to shows that I, to see, TV shows that I like. Who knows this guy on the TV show? House of Cards? Here we go. I like Kevin Spacey in House of Cards, and he also asked himself, why didn't I become Secretary of State? Well, in the end, he became president anyway. But I think the reason why all of this happens, why applications are breaking, is because of this. And I told you I started for a testing company, and I was a tester in the beginning, and I had to test code, and I had to tell developers like you that I found a problem in the code that they wrote. And typically, I tested it on my machine, and it didn't work. And typically, you get the answer, well, it works on my machine. I cannot reproduce it. This is typically the way I see it, and also the way I saw it when I later became a developer. Because everything always worked on my machine, because I had a local environment, and everything was perfect. But basically, the problem with this relationship is that on the one side, testers find bugs. And I'm basically keeping the developers off of building new features. And that doesn't help a whole lot. Okay, I hope you have a better relationship with your testers. Because what I see a lot, the closer we get to a release, it always, of course, it depends on how you develop software. But I know it from our own perspective. I mean, we are a quality company. But still, we also have certain deadlines to meet. And if we get very close to a release date where we have promised our customer we release something on June 21st, we need to release something. And then typically we go away from these bugs and say, well, we'll release it anyway with some known issues. And the thing is, what then sometimes happens, especially for for companies that are very public, you know, that run stuff in production, I don't always test my codes, but when I do it in production. Only a few companies in the world can really afford this. There are companies like Facebook and Etsy, Twitter, and others, they call themselves unicorn, they can do this. They basically release new features to a very small number of people like Facebook. The way Facebook does it, they say, I'm writing a new feature and I'm releasing it to 0.01% of my users. And then I monitor if it's good or not, if they use it or not, or if it's failing. And if it's failing, I fix something. And if it's not failing, then I release it to the next percent. But there's only a few number of companies that can really do this. And because of this attitude of, yeah, we just need to push features out, I think this attitude leads to two very scary numbers. Eighty percent of development time around the world is spent in bug fixing and maintaining code. So if you are engineers, I'm not sure, maybe you are fortunate enough to work in a startup company or building a new project, and hopefully the percentage of writing new code is bigger. But overall, this is a study that was conducted last year. 80% is spent in bug fixing. And I'm sure a lot of you have probably inherited code from somebody else. And that code is super cool, like the code that you wrote back then, right?
Of course.
Of course. So the thing is, that's the reason why, so who is spending too much time in bug fixing and maintaining code? There we go. Yeah. We talked about this today, right?
Yep.
That's the problem. So, and what's even scarier, this is a number from the US alone, but probably it's equally high in Europe. Last year in the United States, bad software was responsible for $60 billion of costs. Because, for instance, Facebook goes down, because Amazon goes down, because people need to come in and work on the weekends and nights. So overall, it's a big number. I know you're all developers and you may not care about these numbers. I'm shifting my presentation to more technical in a second, but this is really important to understand. That bad quality is a big issue, and I think the problem is that we're always trying to think about air quality is something we care about later on. And I hope some of you did some, I don't know, went to university and you had some courses on quality and costs. The later we find a problem, the more expensive it is. I think this should be common sense. And these are actually numbers. It's 150 times more expensive to find and fix a problem once the software is already out there than obviously fixing it early on and not never building it in. And the question is, how do we get out of here? I think, so I'm working with people like you, with companies that have performance problems and have applications crashed and everything, hell is going loose. And what I see with all of these companies are two numbers that make me very happy because I know we can change something. 80% of the problems that I see are only caused by a very small number of problem patterns. It's always the same problems. It's always a handful of things. And that's why I'm here actually, and that's why I'm now switching over to a more technical presentation. I want to take the chance to talk in front of you and tell you which things I'm seeing out there. Because I think you can avoid all of these problems and therefore spend more time in building new features and not fixing bugs. So I think, stop waiting for bug reports. It's time to look behind the scenes. And I want to, as I said before, I want to go through five situations of software projects where I was either actively involved in or people called me in. And I want to show you why something broke, how to avoid it, and this is very key for me, metrics. I'm a big fan of metrics. Why? Because a metric doesn't lie. The number of bugs don't lie, the code coverage doesn't lie, response time of a test doesn't lie. What lies is a good feeling, because today I have a good feeling, tonight if I drink too many beers, tomorrow I have a bad feeling probably. But metrics never lie, especially if you capture them automatically in your continuous integration when you execute your unit tests, which you hopefully have, then these metrics never lie. And before I go to the next slide, I hope you have not eaten dinner yet. Every time when I start a situation, I try to find an image that reflects the situation, and this is the first one. Obviously this is I assume a functional toilet, but what is the problem with this toilet? The architect that defined, that built this toilet into that room probably made not the best decisions. Okay? It works for us guys because we can pee from the side. For girls, it's going to be a little challenging. But what I see in software engineering is not every architect makes good decisions. And before I go into the example, I also want to tell a story from myself. I told you I started my engineering work 15 years ago as a tester, and then I got promoted to a developer, and I got promoted to an architect after 2 years because we had not anybody else to fill that position, because the company, I don't want to only talk bad about me, but the company grew and grew and grew, and so basically the people that were longer with the company were pushed into a position. And I was never educated in architecture. I had no clue about it. The only thing I could do is, based on my best intentions and my best experience, I could make decisions and build something. But looking back a year later at the code that I wrote, I probably thought, man, what did I do? And I'm sure the same will happen to you too. If you look at old code or at code that you inherited and you think, what was this person thinking? The first example I want to bring is from an online room reservation system. So what is this? This is actually from a very large British company, B, that sells petrol. I guess you can connect the dots. And 10 years ago about, an intern, a student, in his semester break, he wrote for one division of that company an online room reservation system where you could go online and say, we have these 3 meeting rooms and I want to reserve it from 1 to 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And everything worked fine. The intern, the student went on, and the system kept growing and growing and growing, and now it is used almost across the globe in this company. With the problem that now when they open up this HTML, the page, it takes between 1 and 2 seconds to show, hey, these are the 5 rooms we have available. And this is obviously not fast, as you can all tell. What they also saw, the symptoms, they have very high garbage collection time on the servers. They were monitoring it through JMX. The assumption of the engineers that are now responsible for that, that inherited that code, was, well, probably some bad garbage collection tuning, because the guy who runs this Tomcat does not have any clue about good garbage collection tuning, and probably it is the database performance. Because they looked at the code and the rendering of this page is so simple, it cannot be anything else. Has anybody of you ever written any additional log statements to figure out what's going on in the code, to figure out a bug? Yeah? That's also what the developers did. To prove their point, what they did, this is now a simplified version of this method. That a room reservation report method that got an office ID, so let's say office Gdansk, and they had a method called load data for office, they had the rendering, and basically what they did a timestamp in the beginning and at the end, and they logged this out to the log file to prove that, hey, you know what, loading the data from the database here, this method is taking 45 seconds. So please, database guy, fix it, because it has to be your database. And the database guy was actually the guy that came to me, and he said, I don't know what to do, because my tools tell me all of the database statements that end up on my side execute faster than 1 millisecond. And this is the same dilemma as I had before with the developer talking to the tester. Now it's the database guy talking to the developer. They don't trust each other. They don't trust each other's tools, because then they also have total different things. So before I go on, I actually want to quickly switch to the stuff that he sent me to show you something live and not only slides. So what this guy did, Joe was his name. Joe was not a Java expert. He was a Sybase expert. Sybase is does anybody know Sybase? Does anybody use Sybase? Yeah? Consider yourself an expert? No, okay. He was an expert, and he came to me and he said, I have no clue about Java, but what I did, I installed, so we have a free product that you can also all download and use, just as he did, and he basically sent me the data. What you see here is what we call a pure path. So every line up here, I think I should point to this one here, so it's on camera, every line here represents somebody opening up that reservation report. And you can see here, the first one takes 60 seconds, the second one 80 seconds, and the third one 133, so 2 minutes. And what our product is actually doing, it is actually showing you which methods are executed, and also, if you scroll down a little further, you see all these different database statements being executed. Okay, you see a lot of SQL statements and so on. And instead of going through the tree, I taught him how to read that view. And I'm zooming in a little bit, because what this view does, it's doing nothing else than visualizing the same execution path, or we call it the pure path, end to end, coming in from Apache, going to Tomcat, and then into Sybase. And if you look closely, there are some numbers on there. And there should be one number that should scare everybody.
66, 25K.
Exactly. 66 is also scary, but this is even more scarier. 24,889 round trips to the database to open up a report that shows 5 rooms. Okay? So, this is basically what I showed him, and I said, honestly, I think you are not the problem. Your database is probably not the problem, but it's the app code that is loading the data. And to approve a little additional point, so you can actually move the mouse over here, and then you can say, show me all these database calls. And then what you can see here is all the individual select statements that were executed. And maybe you see a pattern. This is what we call the n plus 1 query problem. So the same select statement is called all over again with a different ID. So the code was basically retrieving a lot of data with individual round trips. And what was also very interesting, and I'm now switching back to slides because I think it's a little easier from a resolution perspective, because this is what I sent him back to show his engineers. Bum, bum, bum. So let me switch back. Here we go. So first of all, I showed him this screen and I told him a lot of database calls, we saw that. The high time here in CPU on Tomcat, because remember they said a lot of garbage collection happening there. The reason was because they were loading a lot of data into memory that they actually didn't need, and then the garbage collector to clean it out again. I also sent him this screenshot, which was the same that I showed you, but just some additional information here, the classical n plus 1 query problem that is clear. And now this one was very interesting. Actually, what we found out, they did not execute 24,000 statements, but they executed 12,000 statements, or 12,444, and every single select statement was executed on a separate database connection. And the way Sybase works, and that's why I'm happy that I have a Sybase expert in the room. And I had no clue about it. Every time you take a connection out of the connection pool, Sybase sets the security context of that user on the connection. That's why we saw all these set client names. So that's a huge overhead. And to prove his point, Joe was his name, every individual database statement, even as seen from within the application, is really executing faster than 1 millisecond. So he was off the hook. And what was really interesting, why did this happen? It turns out, so this is another view that we have that actually shows where is most of the time spent in which method. And most of the time was actually spent in hash table get. So it turned out that the engineer, or the guy who started the whole project, he had no clue about SQL really. And what he actually built, back then there was no Hibernate, he basically built his own Hibernate. And he built it in a way that every time when somebody opened up that report, he loaded the whole database with individual SQL statements into a big hash table. And on top of that hash table, he built his own entity objects. So here, for instance, is the abstract site entity get room capacity that then went into the hash table and got the capacity of that room. Okay, so every time you open the report, loading the whole database into memory, only needing 5 rooms, and then the garbage collector needs to take care of this. Some of the lessons learned, and that I also want to give you, first of all, the custom measuring that they put in there. So if you ever think about doing your own timestamps, start and stop, please remember that this is only the time as seen by the JVM. The JVM thinks this code takes 10 milliseconds to execute. But if the garbage collector kicks in, you actually see that 10 milliseconds plus however much time the garbage collector needed. So the engineers actually reported wrong times. Also, don't assume you know what the code does that somebody else wrote. They thought this guy probably did a good job and therefore they didn't dig deeper. And also learn SQL or use a real OR mapper. I'm sure Hibernate is something that most of you know. Spring and other entity frameworks, they are good. Okay. I told you I'm a big fan of metrics. Therefore, what I would really like you to do, if you have an application that is accessing the database, try to figure out how often you really go to the database. How many SQL statements do you execute? and also how many of the same SQL statements do you execute? Because this gives you a good input into your architecture. Because if you do the same mistake as they did, executing the same SQL statement 10,000 times, then this is a bad thing for one individual request. And if you execute the same select statement to select the same object across multiple requests, then this is a good candidate for caching. I see a lot of people putting configuration elements in a database, and everybody that opens up the screen, or if I open up multiple screens, you always go to the database and capture the same static value that never changes. And another interesting thing is this one. This is a metric that most people never think about, because most people typically only think about connection pool utilization. I tell you, connection acquisition time is a very interesting one. What does this mean? Connection acquisition time means how long does it take for me as the developer to get the next connection out of the pool. And the reason why this is important as compared to the connection pool usage utilization, if you have 100% connections utilized, it could either mean you have a problem or you have the best system in the world. Because if you have 50 connections in the pool and you only need 50, then 100% is okay. The problem is the 51st request, because you're requesting something that is not available. And that's what we call the connection acquisition time. How long does it take for me to take the next connection out? And that's not only a metric for database connections, but also for thread pools. Okay? Please keep this in mind. Next example. I told you I always try to use images that reflect the picture. It says, you call it cheating, I call it multi-threading. And I heard the term microservices so much before. So what I see a lot of people doing now, they are thinking they have a monolithic application, and I think this is what microservices try to do. Let's rip it apart and build a lot of services, and everything will be much better because I can scale every single service endlessly, because I can run it in 10,000 Docker containers, or I use it wherever I want. Before I move to the next slide, this is a Swedish company, and they are hosting all the sports club websites for every sports club in Sweden. So if you go online and if you search for soccer clubs in Stockholm, you get 33 elements back. 33 sports clubs, and I see the name, the address, and maybe an image. And this used to be a monolithic application, all implemented in one box, and they said, we need to extract that. We need to build a microservice, a front end and a back end. And this is what they got when we looked at their data, because they said something is slow after we re-architectured everything to microservices. You know what the transaction flow is by now, so it's end-to-end flow. And what's interesting, they have the front end, the back end, and the database. And the first thing I immediately see here, first of all, in order to query to get these 33 clubs, it took 26 seconds to execute. The front end is making a direct connection to the database, and it turned out what they are doing, when I enter a search key and I search for Stockholm soccer clubs, they make a SQL statement which returns all of these 33 unique IDs, the primary keys, and then for every single sports club they make an additional service call, because now they are microservices, right? Now they are going 33 times over the wire. And this is two different servers. That means you have network latency and all that stuff. And every single microservice now, instead of just going once to the database, every microservice needs to go to the database about 6 times, because every microservice needs the same basic static information from the database. That's why in total, this is an architecture that doesn't work for me. And one picture tells it all. So if you have a conference about microservices later this year, I think you should tell them that just defining an interface and thinking that this, you can extract this into a microservice, this is not service-oriented architecture. You need to really think about the whole thing.
That's exactly the point we will be making. No, it's not single bullet, silver bullet.
Yeah.
Think, and it fits in a certain context.
Yeah. Perfect. And another example, similar, and I'm just walking through this very quickly. This is an online a financial institution, same thing. They had a web request coming in where people could sign up to their insurance policies online, It took up to 12 minutes for a single request, and they also ripped the whole thing apart, and it turned out that every single, this used to be a monolith, this used to be one JVM, they ripped it apart and used RMI. For every request now, they had 64 RMI calls going on between to do the same thing. Before, they re-architectured, it was all local calls. And every single service also needs to go to an external system, which happens to be Siebel, which is standing somewhere in a total remote location. And again, every service needs to capture the same things multiple times. What they also did, these calls, they did these remoting calls on synchronously, or actually they spawned 13 background threads and then made these calls synchronously. So every single request that came in here consumed 14 threads here, 14 Java threads. And that obviously doesn't allow you to scale really well. Yeah, and there's some additional things. I will walk through this a lot quickly because you can get the slides. But this, you've seen this before. This is the pure path. We've seen a pure path before in my live demo. So this really shows the full execution path. We show when a method executes another thread and calling some other stuff on background threads. So we see that every thread actually makes an RMI call. And we also see the thread IDs. So this is how we could prove that they are consuming for every request 13 different background threads. And that's not very efficient. And the other thing that they did is, anybody using Oracle Coherence or any similar product, any caching? Yeah. What they also did, because they parallelized everything, now they have 13 calls, all of these calls also went to Oracle Coherence, to a shared cache, and Oracle Coherence was incorrectly configured and overwhelmed by the new load. That's why the hotspot was actually waiting on the connection for Oracle Coherence, to get a connection to that cache. Okay? Yeah, and some more examples. A lot of background threads. So, I told you I'm a big fan of metrics. If you are implementing something, or if you are charged with doing some re-architecture, figure out how many Java threads you're now really using. How many service calls are you really doing? Are you doing one service call or 500 service calls? And also, what's very interesting, if you go to a service-oriented architecture and you're now making service calls, you also want to figure out what's the payload. Do I send 1 kilobyte or 100 kilobyte per call? Because if you are hosting this in Amazon or in other cloud providers, you might be charged by network traffic. And that's why every bad architectural decision also has an immediate impact on the costs it takes to run that software. Okay? Next example. Who knows this guy? Who doesn't know the guy? Okay, so this guy, he is a character from Game of Thrones. So you've never seen Game of Thrones. He's the evil king. Fortunately, in the latest seasons, huh?
Spoiler alert.
He deserved justice. Anyway, this guy, he became king. He was put, or I call it, he was deployed on the Iron Throne. And there's good and bad deployments. Good kings and bad kings, and the same is true with software. There's good and bad deployments. And I sometimes see deployments really gone bad. And I want to give you one example. And now I need two volunteers. What's your name?
Adam.
Adam? That was an easy one. You?
Czarek.
Okay. So Adam, what you are doing, what you are now somebody that sells products online. Consider eBay, for instance. You put something on eBay, and Czarek, you are a customer, and you want to buy stuff from him, okay? So the company I'm talking about now is not eBay, but very similar. And what they have, it's a US-based company. And what they did, US-based companies are very happy, but also afraid of what they call the shopping holiday season. Starts shortly before Thanksgiving, where everything is going online and buying crazy stuff. And so therefore, everybody is testing their new version of their website. And what you see here is, again, another transaction flow from their test environment. And they were testing the use case where you, as a seller, is basically probably once a day going into that system and say, how many products did I sell to him? And they were testing this, but they were also testing your use case. How long does it take to get buy something. And that use case was really fine. Your use case, I know it's a little hard to see here, but I think it says something like 42 seconds to get that report. And they also saw that they had about 1,800 calls to the database. And they were saying, sorry, Adam, he's more important. You can wait 42 seconds for your report. But you are making the money. So they saw these numbers and said, we have no time to fix this, so we just go live. And we think everything will be good. And they tested everything with load testing tools and everything they thought did a good job. Then they deployed everything in production, and then these things happened. So your report now took 8 times longer, almost 6 minutes. You were obviously pissed, because you need to wait 6 minutes to know if you sold something. And from an infrastructure perspective, they had 3 times more calls to the database. And this was very interesting, because they thought, this cannot be, because we tested everything with a lot of load in testing. How can this be? Does anyone want to take a guess what the differences may have been between testing and production?
Database size?
Database size was one thing. What they did not anticipate, they took the database from 2013 and didn't think about that every year more products are sold online. And they did not anticipate that people like Adam is putting all the products online 2 days before Thanksgiving to make sure everything is online. So wrong database size.
They were testing independently client events and report events. They were testing independently. They went together. There was higher level.
They did a good amount of testing. So this was not the problem. They really tested everything. What they did not know is, first of all, the data. Then what they thought, that you were only checking it once a day and not every 10 minutes, because you want to do something. And the other thing, and this is why I call this whole thing deployment gone bad, because what really happened was something that should never happen.
Different machines.
Not different machines, but very, very close. So, what you see here is what we call a response time hotspot, and these individual bars here show in which layer of your application is most of the time spent. The top layer is the web server, and that's normal. Most of the time in a web application, most of the work is done by the web server in I/O, sending back HTML, JavaScript files, and all that stuff. Next is Hibernate, web services, JDBC, and then their own code base. The same thing in production showed a total different picture. Now the number one is Hibernate, followed by custom monkey, class loading, custom monkey, and XML processing. There was nowhere web server anymore, because everything moved totally. And what was interesting is we looked at a similar view that you saw before. So we analyzed, what is the slowest method? The slowest method turned out to be class get interfaces, and I'm sure most of you know what that is. That's Java reflection. And by clicking on that element here on the bottom, you can actually see who is making these calls to Java reflection. And it turned out it was all done by Hibernate, the field interception helper. And they thought, why is this a performance problem in prod but not in testing? So what they did, they went on Google, searched for Hibernate field interception helper, and the first thing that came back was a Jira ticket on the Hibernate project, well-known performance bug in that version of Hibernate. The question is, why didn't they find it in testing?
Different Hibernate version.
Exactly. So somebody made the decision one day before Thanksgiving that they had to upgrade the Hibernate version in production. Yeah? And we all laugh about it, but this happens. And normally this should not happen, because you should only release software that you test, and Hibernate is part of your software. It's not only your code. You need to test everything and need to deploy everything together. They were unlucky to pick a version that didn't work. And the second thing that happened, which was also interesting, a second decision was made to exchange the XML parser that they use. So instead of XiaXS, they used Xalan, because somebody read this is better performing, and this actually also had a worse impact on them. So they basically had a total different system in production than in testing. The metrics that I want to tell you that you should look at. What you should do, if you are serious about performance, then next time when I maybe speak here, I at least want to have some hands raised that do some performance testing, at least some JMeter tests where you execute at least some load. And what you want to do is you want to figure out how much time do I spend in the individual layers, how much time do I spend in web server, in JDBC, in Hibernate, and how does this change the more load I put on? Because then you can immediately see which layer is scaling and which layer is not scaling. And also, how many calls do I have to a certain API? Do I call into Hibernate once or 1,000 times? Do I call into the XML parser once or 1,000 times? Okay, so these are things that you should please look at. I have two more examples, then I release you. So this is an example where this is a room of people, and typically what I say, the guy, all of these guys here, they probably earn more than we all together. So these are the people that make the good decisions. And what I see a lot, and I'm sure this happens in your company as well, somebody has a great idea or some sales guy sold something to a customer and we have to have it tomorrow. Okay? Does this happen sometimes? And then you have to implement something as fast as possible without really having a plan. And same here, this guy said, I think we need a mobile strategy because everybody's going mobile, we need to have a mobile website. And the guy in the back who is checking his Twitter account or Facebook says, sure, we'll do something. So what I call this is sometimes push without a plan. And the example, before I move to the next slide, is a very cool one, and I always have to put up my phone, my old iPhone 4. This example is from a large soft drink company in the US, and it's not Coca-Cola. And it's also not Red Bull, because Red Bull, I typically get, it's Red Bull. And I said, Red Bull is not US, it's Austrian. In case you didn't know, Red Bull is Austrian. We're very proud of the guy who screwed his business partner in Asia and make all the money. But this company, they had a very cool business idea. So this company, this software company, sponsored the American Super Bowl. Who is watching the Super Bowl? Anybody? Nobody? Ads, for instance, yeah. The sport is also interesting. Anyway, what they thought, there are millions of people watching the Super Bowl, and what we want to show social connectivity. We want to connect with the audience. And there's a lot of people worldwide watching the Super Bowl, and they all have parties. They have parties like this, sitting in a room and watching this on the big screen. And what we want them to do, and I'm doing this now, we want them to take a selfie, and we want them to upload the selfie to our website, so when our ad runs and people go to the mobile website of ours, they see the last 400 uploads of the selfies in a 20 by 20 grid. So 20 by 20 images to show how cool we connect, how social we are. Okay? This makes a lot of sense if you are doing this for a website that you can put on a screen like this, 20 by 20. But if this is your mobile strategy and your screen is like my iPhone and you try to show 20 by 20 images here, you don't see a whole lot of faces. You just see pixels. Okay? Still a great idea, but implementation, because it was pushed out without, I think, having a real plan, was even worse. There's two numbers that I show you now that will scare you. In order to download, to go to the mobile website of their company, I had to download 20 megabytes. A total of 434 individual images. I know that not a whole lot of you are web developers, but if you have a little common sense, then you don't, if you want to display 20 by 20 images, you don't need to let them download individually, but typically you would create a thumbnail, 20 by 20, maybe in three sizes, one for the big screen, one for the tablet, and one for my iPhone. And then with this, you can reduce 399 round trips. And the reason why the size was so big, because even I on my iPhone, every image was was like 50 to 100 kilobytes. Because then let my phone download the full size, and then let my phone squeeze it down to 5x5 pixels or something like that. Okay? So in case you ever have to implement something like this, please think twice and please ask for more time or at least make them aware of it. Because this didn't really work well. And also what I always say, I'm not sure how it is here with your mobile data plans. How much you have to pay for per megabytes? I know. I mean, if you are local, it typically some gigabytes might be included. I travel a lot, and if I travel with my business phone and I go to the US, I pay 15 euros per megabyte. That means if I open up this page because I want to see how they are doing, this is 315. Yeah, it's 300 euros for downloading a page that doesn't really make sense on my screen. Yeah? And then I need to explain this to my boss. What did you do? Where do all these mobile charges come from? Yeah. Okay. Now, I don't only want to blame American companies, because we have some very good examples as well. FIFA. The largest element on the mobile FIFA World Cup page was the FAF icon. With 370 kilobytes. And those people that don't know the FAF icon, it's a little icon in your browser bar, top left, or if you pin the page on your mobile phone, it's a logo. And typically that's a couple of bytes. And what they basically did, somebody probably didn't want to see all these HTTP requests coming in from browsers that the server responds with HTTP 404, not found. Somebody just took the high resolution PNG of the company logo and converted it into an icon file and put it on the web server. And that cost them a lot of money, because I'm sure millions of people were using their mobile website. It's a lot of bandwidth. Yeah. And the reason why I'm actually, I mean, we wrote, you can see the slides are all online, and also there's links to blog posts that we wrote about it. If you are considering or ever need to develop something like this, there's a lot of tools out there built in your browser. Every browser, Chrome, Safari, Firefox, even Microsoft's Internet Explorer now has built-in tools that tell you all of this. So when you have to do any web development, please use these tools that tell you your page is totally overloaded. And the images, the metrics that I always look at is how many images are we loading, how many redirects do we have. I wrote more on this on the blog post, and also the size of resources. Do I need to download 1 megabyte or 10 megabytes? Because that makes a huge difference. Because speed matters. And I'm sure you're also impatient if you have to wait too long to download a website. I'm coming to my last example. And I know none of you watches the Super Bowl, but I do. Kia is another sponsor. And what they did last year was pretty cool. They had a spot. It was a Hollywood production, 90 seconds, where Godzilla was chasing Kia cars through, I think, Chicago. And 90 seconds TV ad is $12 million. So $12 million in marketing budget and probably more millions to produce the spot. So let me ask you a question. Why would a company spend $12 million? What would they, why do they do it? What's their hope? What do they think they will get from it?
People want to buy their cars.
People want to buy their cars, ad clicks. Yeah, people want to go to their website. So watching the Super Bowl half drunk, let's go to Kia.com. And it could happen, right? I don't know. So if you think about this, this is the biggest single sport event in the world, and the most people probably in the year will click on their website. So they can probably anticipate this is the largest load they ever seen in the year. And typically people should prepare for that. So what I call this is not, they didn't really have an agile deployment. The next slide that I show you is something that we also do when we monitor performance of websites, because not only is it important to monitor how are your servers doing, are they burning off or are they doing okay, you also need to figure out, is anybody able to access your website right now, your servers? Maybe you're offline and nobody knows about it. That's why if you're serious about it, you typically have what's called synthetic monitoring. So you do availability and performance monitoring from different points in the world. And what you see here is the availability chart of Kia.com during the Super Bowl. It was 100% until the ad that they had with the cool cars went on air. Then the availability dropped to zero. That means most people that tried to see their website didn't get to it. And that's $12 million invested wisely, because I have a story to tell, but probably not so wisely because they didn't sell a whole lot of cars. And before I tell you why this happened, I want to show you a different example. This example is from GoDaddy. I'm not just GoDaddy known in Poland, hosting company. So GoDaddy, you can host your website with GoDaddy. And I call this GoDaddy Goes DevOps. What you see here is not the availability, but the response time. And the response time of GoDaddy.com was between 1.5 and 2 seconds until 1 hour before the Super Bowl, and there we saw something very interesting. The website became 4 times faster. So what we thought, probably the website already crashed and the only thing they show is some funny, sorry, come back later. That's what we thought. But what we did, we opened up the browser and looked at what they did. And what they did is they said, when we spend millions of dollars to try to tell people what we sell and get them on our website, then we want to tell them what we sell, but we don't need to tell them how many friends on Facebook like us. We don't need to tell them what's going on Twitter. We don't need to tell them high resolution images, how cool we are and how cool our graphics department are. We just show them a page that says, this is what we do, this is what we cost. So they built a trimmed down version of their website exactly for that period of time. They were 100% available, much faster than anybody else during the peak period, and an hour after the Super Bowl, they flipped back the switch to the full-blown website. And Kia did something else. Kia basically had, I guess, pride. Obviously, they have nice cars. They had high-resolution images on there. They had the video on their website. And obviously, they were hosting it on a CDN. But the thing is, everybody is using the same CDNs anyway during the Super Bowl. So every company that is sponsoring drives traffic to exactly the same services. CDNs, Facebook, Twitter. And they all basically became slower and therefore also impacted Kia, but not GoDaddy, because GoDaddy said we don't need all this. Not for these 4 hours. Okay. So the metrics that I always look at when I analyze a website, I look at how many domains are actually involved to download a site. It's very interesting if you open up tools like YSlow, PageSpeed, the development tools that are built in. And if you, for instance, see that you are, like in GoDaddy's case, in the full-blown version, they had 26 different domains. In the small version, they only have 8. So they cut 16 external service providers and therefore focus much more on their own servers. And also the total size was very important, cutting down on size. So what have we learned today? I hope, first of all, that we also drink beer in Linz. Remember the beginning? I hope you learned that database access can be very tricky. But what I really want you to take home with you, maybe not all of them, but if you do me a favor and pick one of these metrics and try to figure out how can you figure out in your own code, on your own application you're responsible for, how can I get, for instance, the number of SQL executions that my code is executing? Or if I build a website, how many images do I have on that page? And you check this value before you check in your code and think about it, is this a good number or not? This is where it starts. But I don't want to tell you that you need to do this manually for every single thing that you want to do. I think we can do much better, because this is where we are going to. I think we're automating as much as possible as we can these days. Who is having any CI, continuous integration, Jenkins, Bamboo? Yeah, that's a good lot of hands. I hope you're all executing your unit tests. Okay? How many unit tests do you execute? Don't make up a number. Who wants to say how many unit tests they're executing? Come on. There's no wrong number.
If it's greater than zero.
If it's greater than zero, it's no wrong number.
2,000.
2,000? Who said that? 2,000 per build?
Yes.
Awesome. What does a unit test do? What does a unit test tell you, the result? Yeah, but typically, if it's green, what does it mean?
No regression. It means that there was no regression.
There was no functional regression. You're basically testing functionality. And red means functionality broke. So in a typical scenario, And this is now very simplified. If you have build number 17 and you have two unit tests and they all return green, then everything is green. Functional. You can purchase something and you can search something. If in the next build one of the tests fails, you know you have to go back in your code revision history and say, what did I change? And then you think, oh my god, I want to build this new feature and I want to just fix this very quickly so that everything is green again. What I tell you, and if you think about all the metrics that I told you, why not hook up your unit testing framework or your automation scripts, maybe you use Selenium or other tools or QuickTest Pro, whatever, why not hook them up with tools like Dynatrace, with tools like AppDynamics, New Relic, any profiling tool out there, and capture additional metrics like the number of SQL statements, the number of exceptions, time spent on CPU, the number of images, the number of service calls, all the metrics that I told you. Because if you do this, first of all, you get a much better picture. You automatically see, hey, well, I'm calling 12 database statements, okay, that sounds reasonable. No exceptions, that's good here. Here's one exception, but it's probably handled properly because everything is green, good. If the test 18 fails, if you have tracing turned on, you get additional information about maybe some Hibernate exceptions that are all covered underneath the hood because somebody handles it, but they could give you more input on what is really going on. So it makes it easier for you to fix the problem instead of just looking at the JUnit assertion. And if you fix something very quickly because you want to go on to the next feature, and you see something like this, yes, we fixed it, we can purchase again, but now we're executing 6 times as many database statements, and we are spending twice as much time on CPU, then from my perspective, if I'm your project lead, I'm stopping this build. Because you just introduced an architectural regression that will either kill your load testing later on or your production environment, unless you buy 5 more database servers. So what I'm telling you, metrics don't lie, and if you connect your existing unit test scenarios with some tools that can give you these metrics, then you get to this here. Functional green and architectural green, this is what we want. And how this could look like, so we have, this is the only ad I want to do. So I mean, you have seen our tool before. Our tool is free for every developer, so you can download it, you can use it as long as you want on your local machine. And we also have a cool feature that does exactly that what I just told you. We are analyzing every single unit test or every single performance test, and we look at these metrics. Response time, number of database statements, and we learn over time how many database statements you should have. And in case, from one build to the next, the database statements jump up like crazy, we say, we believe this build is bad. This is how it looks like in our UI. So we basically show you every build, how our point of the world looks like, how many, from our point of view, tests are good and bad. And you can even integrate it with Jenkins. And if you don't like the colors, you can change them too. But this is the way I think software engineering
question.
Yeah?
Do you want questions now or later?
I'm almost done. Let's do it in 3 minutes.
Sure.
Yeah? So, but this is, I think, how we can revolutionize the way we think about quality by stopping builds early on, because otherwise I will find it in production. And it's always the same problems. And I know that most of you, well, I think only one or two raised their hands when I asked, do you do performance analysis or performance testing? I do it every day. And therefore, what I offer, I actually offer my expertise online. And what I do every other week, so every second week, I'm doing an online performance clinic where I show 30 minutes how I analyze a certain aspect of an application and also the lessons learned. So similar what I do here, but just condensed on a particular topic. And then everything gets put up on YouTube. So you can watch all the stuff that I've done. And there's also an open Q&A. And what I also do, in case you're considering using our free tool, and I know it looked nice and easy with the screenshots, and it is actually not that hard, but it can do a lot of things. And I do it every day, so I actually allow you to send me your data, and then I look at the stuff. Similar what I showed you in all these examples. These examples are people that sent me their data and I looked at it. And if you do this, your benefits are you get a free performance review, I give you an extended license of our product, and my benefits, I have more material for blogs or conferences, and I will not give your name unless you allow me to do so, or I find a very creative way of hiding the name. And obviously I have a big gratification to help you. And with this, I want to open it up for Q&A, and these are some links. I put all of my slides on SlideShare, and you will find I had different presentations for Java meetups, for web performance meetups, for .NET meetups, for testers meetups. So there's a lot of stuff on there. The tool, you can download it and register on this link, bit.ly DT trial. If you register, don't get scared, you get an email from me, because I run the free trial program. So look out for an email from Andy Grabner, and also look in the spam folder. Sometimes it ends up in spam. Feel free to follow me on Twitter, or also read more stories on our blog. And I really hope that, I mean, I don't want to get out of job because I'm doing this for so many years and there's still all the problems, that all the same problems all the time. I still hope you get some ideas on which problems you can solve on your own machine. And stop bad quality early. And now I want to open it up for questions. If anybody has questions.
Yeah, I had one.
Yeah.
The integration with Jenkins that you showed.
Yeah.
It's triggered on every build.
Exactly. So
how it impacts the build time?
How it impacts the build? The build time, not at all. What we do, in order to get our product in, and this is the same for every performance tracing tool out there, we hook into the JVM, so you load an additional library on your JVM command line option. So you have we use JVM TI, so it's basically a native interface, so you don't need to make any code changes. And what we do during loading of your JUnit tests, we basically instrument your code. So we put individual instrumentation points into well-known JUnit, JDBC, RMI remoting calls, and then intercept these calls. So from a performance impact, most of our clients run this product 24/7 in production. We have companies like Bank of America, Fidelity, in Poland, I think we have some of the bigger names here too. So the overhead is almost not measurable. And that's why we believe that this is something that you want to use in your CI. And whether it's our product or the competitor product, you need to figure out what's best for you as well. But I think we are spearheading here. I think we started this track of measuring performance, but not only performance. It's not about performance, actually. I think for me, it's about architectural regressions. Because if a unit test takes 1 millisecond or two, doesn't mean it's slow. I don't want to actually look at performance here, at response time. I want to look at 5 database statements of 500. That's what I care about.
My question was more rising that there is this ultimate goal for having a fast build and run the unit test as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
And then I was just curious, so if we put some additional level of investigation around.
Yeah. So obviously it will add maybe 2-3% of your execution time to it. But the thing is, who said the 2,000 unit tests? Yeah. If you have 2,000 unit tests, most of them will really only test a very small method. It doesn't make sense. I think it makes sense for those unit tests that test
integration,
yeah. Test the microservices or the way you are interacting with services. So it's more integration tests where actually you have interactions with the database, interactions with certain APIs like Hibernate. There it makes sense.
Okay. That answers my question.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Well, then I hope it was useful and not only boring. Nobody threw tomatoes on me, but I guess that's why, because nobody typically carries tomatoes around. Feel free to contact me. I'll stick around a little bit longer if you have questions. And I think the biggest thing is we have a raffle now.
Yes.
Because we have a sponsor. Who is the sponsor?
The Gecko. The conference organizers.
The conference organizers.
Kind of running conference, so we have a raffle.
Yeah.
And just.
So that means I want to hand it.
JetBrains.
Yeah. So I want to hand it back to you then to do the raffle.
Yeah. So thank you, Andy.